Hi friends, today we'll discuss about this material requirement planning. So this material requirement planning plays a vital role in the manufacturing industry. It is nothing but it is a computational technique that converts the master schedule for end products into a detailed schedule for the raw materials and the components used in the end product. So this detailed schedule identifies the quantities of each raw material and component item which are used in the product. It also indicates the when each item must be ordered and delivered to meet the master schedule for the final product. MRP also gives the inventory level which of the industry. It is both an effective tool for minimizing the unnecessary inventory investment and a useful technique for the production schedule and purchasing of a raw material. So the definition gives that it is a computer-based information system for ordering and scheduling of dependent demands inventories, that is what is needed, how much is needed, and when it is needed. It mainly, the MRP mainly depends on dependent demands and the independent demands. So independent demand is nothing but the final product, that is the finished product. Dependent demand is nothing but the raw materials or assemblies, components which are used to make the final product, those are the dependent demands. So the independent demand can be easily forecasted. We can easily forecast the independent demands. For example, the sales of the car in the particular week or the month can be easily forecasted, and the spare parts, so they can be easily forecasted. They come under the independent demands. So where the dependent demand cannot be easily forecasted, okay, the raw materials or the sub assembly or the components cannot be easily forecasted. Those are the example for the dependent demands. So then how this MRP works? So the goal of the MRP or material requirement planning document is to supply the information that will enable the company to have enough inventory on hand to fulfill the demand, available only when needed, at a quality level that meets the specification and at the lowest price. As I told, so the MRP is mainly related to the inventory level of the manufacturing industry. So too little inventory is also a problem, too high inventory is also a problem. So we should maintain a proper medium inventory level at the manufacturing industry. So this MRP is mainly related to the inventory, that is nothing but the raw material. A good MRP or material requirement planning program can provide the basic needs of keeping inventory levels low and fulfilling the customer expectation for a timer delivery. So this MRP gives the manufacturing industry to maintain a proper inventory level at the industry and to provide the customer satisfaction and by delivering the products at a proper time. So there are two important questions to ask here. So related to the MRP, how much of item is needed, that is the what is the amount of the raw material is needed, and when an item is needed to complete a specified number of units in a specified period of time. The MRP process involves the following steps. So in order to determine the MRP, that is material required for the manufacturing of a product, so first we have to calculate what are the gross requirements for a particular items. What are the gross requirements in the raw materials? So then we have to determine the what are the net requirements and when orders will be released for the fabrication or sub assemblies. So then the net requirements is given by total requirements minus available inventory will give the net requirements. So net require final the net requirements is given by so gross requirements plus allocations. What are the allocations which are for the machines minus on hand, means already we are having the some amount of inventory in the industry. So plus scheduled receipts. Scheduled receipts is nothing but the so which we have given the purchase order. So for the raw materials, those are nothing but the which we are receiving in the coming weeks. So all together will give you the net requirements. So then what are the what can MRP do? So what are the benefits by using this MRP system? So it reduces the inventory levels, as I told. So the too little inventory is also a problem, too high inventory is also a problem, such that we have to maintain a proper medium inventory levels at the industry. So it reduces the component shortages. Okay, it will properly manage the requirement number of components for the manufacturing and also the sub assemblies, so that the reduce of the component shortages it will make. Improve the shipping performance. The MRP also improves the shipping performance. Improve customer service so that we can manufacture the good number of units and we can deliver to the customer as and when they are required. So it improves the production rate, that is nothing but the productivity. It is a simplified and accurate scheduling when compared with the manual manual preparation of the raw materials requirements. Then it reduces the purchasing cost. It also reduces the purchasing cost and improve the production schedules and reduce the manufacturing cost. The MRP also reduces the manufacturing cost along with the manufacturing lead times. And with the help of this MRP, so we'll be having a less scrap and rework, and also high production quality. The quality of the products will be very good with the help of this material requirement planning system. So there are some fundamental concepts are there in the material requirement planning system. So they are one is independent demand and the dependent demands, manufacturing lead time, and common use items. So as I told, so dependent demand is nothing but the final product, and independent demand is nothing but the final product, and dependent demand is nothing but the sub assemblies or the components which are used in the final product. So you can see here, independent demand is nothing, that is A is a final product. In this A, we have used the B, C, D, E, and F. So they are nothing but the sub assemblies and the component parts. They come under the dependent demands. So we have used B, that is the sub assembly in A, four components. C is nothing, it is also one more sub assembly, two components, and this B is made by D and E. So D is of two parts and E is having one part, and in this C sub assembly we are having D three components and F two components. So you can see the simple example here. So this table, 100 tables, they come under the independent demands. They are not depending upon the any other. It is a final product that comes under the independent demand. Whereas, so this table tops, 100 table tops and 100 into 4 table legs. So these come under the dependent demands. So these 4 legs are depending on this table top. This table top is depending upon the four legs. So they come under the, they are dependents. So hence they come under the dependent demands. And also you can see here, so the bicycle, computers, so they are all the final product that they come under the independent demands. The tires which are used in the car and the microchip which are used in the motherboards, so they are the sub assemblies which come under the dependent demands. So manufacturing lead time. So in this manufacturing lead time, we are having ordering lead time and the manufacturing lead time. So ordering lead time is nothing but the, so we have ordered the raw materials to procure. So that is nothing but the ordering lead time for the purchasing of the parts. So initiation of the purchase required, from which day or the which time we have given the order to the supplier, from that day and until the supplier supplies the raw materials, that is nothing but the ordering lead time. And the manufacturing lead time is nothing but the customer has given the order, that is we have placed the orders and we are delivering the item to the customer, that time is nothing but the manufacturing time. So common use items, so the MRP collects the common use items for different products to affect economics in ordering the raw materials and manufacturing the components and the sub assemblies. Some of the components which will be used for the different products. So the MRP, it also collects the information of the commonly used items which are in the different products also. You can see in this case that we are having a products, that is P1, P2, P3 up to P1. In all these products, there are some of the components which are used in the all the products. Okay, so they must be calculated in the MRP. So we can see here, so these are the C1, C2, C3, CN. So these are the commonly used items in all the P1 to PN products. They must be included in the MRP system. That is nothing but the common use items. So then, structure or input to the MRP system. What are the input to the MRP system? So this is the block diagram. You can see this is the input to the MRP system. So this is the MRP processor, which is nothing but the computer software. And to this MRP processor, we are inputting three main inputs. That is nothing but the master production schedule, bill of material, inventory record file. Okay, so there are mainly three inputs to this MRP processor, that is master production schedule, bill of material, and inventory record file. So this for MRP processor, we are also inputting the service part requirements. Service part requirements is nothing but the as I told, so the in the case of independent demand, so we are having the independent demands, that is nothing but the final products and the spare parts, they come under the independent demands. So that must also be included in the MRP process. And this master production schedule, it mainly depends on the sales forecasting and the customer order. So the bill of material is related to the drawing related to the product, and inventory record file is nothing but it is related to the what is the status of the inventory. From this MRP system, it gives the output reports. Okay, so the MRP processor or the system, it gives the output reports. What are the output reports? That is the gross and net requirements of the products, capacity versus load reports, shop floor planning reports, production order status, and exceptions report. So these are the output reports of the MRP system. So as you can see that, so once again, so the MRP processor is there. To this MRP processor, we are having three inputs, that is the master production schedule, bill of material, and inventory record file. So this master production schedule is mainly the data which is given by the sales forecasting. And also for this MRP system, we are having the service parts requirements is also the input to the MRP system. And for this master production schedule, we will be having the customer orders. So bill of material is related to the drawings related to the product, and inventory record file is nothing but the status of the inventory which is there in the industry. The MRP system, it gives the certain outputs, that is nothing but the output reports. So the output reports are gross and net requirements, capacity versus load reports, shop floor planning reports, and production order status and exceptions report. So inputs to the MRP system, as I told in that block diagram, so there are mainly three inputs are there: master production schedule, bill of materials, inventory record file. So this master production schedule is nothing, it is expressed in terms of the time buckets, nothing but the in which week, how many products we are manufacturing, that in the particular is that is termed as the time buckets. So bill of material, it is a product structure, and it lists all the components which are there in the final products. A triangle tree will be prepared so that all the products which are there, all the parts which are there in the final product, they will be listed in the form of a tree. That, and the third one is the inventory record file. So this includes the item master data, what is the part number, what are the order quantity, how many quantities are ordered, and what is the lead time for the preparation of the products. Inventory status, so it gives the inventory status, what is the inventory status of the raw materials or the components or the sub assemblies which are used in the products. Subsidiary data, so subsidiary data is nothing but what are the purchasing orders, whether and whether any drawing changes are there. So that data is related to the subsidiary data. Master production schedule. Master production schedule, it states which end items are to be produced, when they are needed, and in what quantities. So the master production schedule will give you the data related to the which end items are to be produced in particular week, when they are needed, and in what quantities they must be delivered to the customer. So you can see in the table that in the particular weeks, that is in April, May, June, in week 1, week 2, week 3, week 4, and the product is that it is a coffee mug, and the size we are manufacturing in different, that is small, medium, large. In small, in the first week of the April, so 5800 are manufactured, and the medium size 5800 are manufactured, large size 4306 are manufactured. In the same way, it is the master production schedule is related to the in which week how many quantities of the products are manufactured. So the master production schedule is a schedule of how much and when to produce the independent demand. Okay, so it produces the independent demand based on the customer order, based on the customer order. So the this master production schedule will be prepared. So it shows when the end product is needed, but does not show when raw materials, components, sub assemblies or parts are needed. The master production schedule does not show the what are the raw materials, components, sub assemblies or the parts are needed for the manufacturing of the product. It only gives the what are the total number of quantities, that is the final products which are required in the particular week. Bill of material. So you can see that, so the bill of material file provides the information about the product structure by listing the components, parts and sub assemblies that make up the each product. It is used to compute the raw material and components requirement for the end products listed in the master schedule. So based on that master schedule, so the product structure will be prepared. So you can see that in the, this is the bill of material. So this is P1 is the final product. In this P1, that is a product, we are having two sub assemblies, that is sub assembly S1 and sub assembly S2. In this P1, the sub assembly quantity is 1. In this P1, the sub assembly quantity S2 is having two numbers. Okay, you can see in this here that two numbers are there. S2 in the P1, they are having two numbers. And the components, okay, in this sub assembly, what are the components are there? So the C1, C2, C3, they are the components to prepare the sub assembly S1. Then how many quantities of C1, C2, C3 are there? The C1, the quantity is 1, C2, the quantity is 4, C3, the quantity is 1. So all together make a sub assembly S1. And similarly, in the S2, we are having C4, C5, C6. So C4, we are having two numbers, C5, we are having two numbers, C6, we are having one number. All together, C4, C5, C6 make a sub assembly S2. Then in order to prepare this component, that is C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, we require the raw materials. So the raw material, that is the M1, it is a raw material to prepare C1, one quantity. To prepare C2, we require the M2 raw material, what is one component and one number. For preparing the C3, we require the M3 raw material, that is the one number. Similarly for the C4, C5, C6. So the bill of material, it gives the product structure for producing the product. So then inventory record file. So the inventory record file is referred to as the item master file is in a computerized inventory system. So the types of data contained in the inventory record file are divided into the three segments. So inventory record file will give the what is the status of the inventory in the manufacturing industry. So this data, it contains three segments: item master data, inventory status, subsidiary data. Item master data is nothing but it provides the items identification, that is nothing but the part number. It gives the identification for the part number and other data about the part, such as order quantity and lead times. Okay, how many quantities are ordered by the customer, that order quantity, and what is the manufacturing lead time associated with the that product. That is nothing but the item master data. Then inventory status, this gives a time phased record of inventory status. In MRP, it is important to know not only the current level of inventory but also any future changes that will occur against the inventory. Therefore, the inventory status segment lists the gross requirement for the item, scheduled receipts, on hand status, and planned order releases. Okay, so you can see that in the inventory status, so it gives the information what are the gross requirements of the items and also the scheduled receipts which are going to be received by the supplier, and on hand status, that is nothing but what we are having already in the industry, and future forecasted demand of the product, that is nothing but the planned order releases, what we have planned to release the products in the market in order to prepare that market in order to prepare that product. So we require the raw materials, what are the planned order releases, so that all inventory status will be maintained in the that is the second one, that segment, that is the inventory status. The third one is nothing but the subsidiary data. The third final segment, which provides the subsidiary data such as purchase orders, scrap or rejects, and any engineering changes which is there in the product. That is nothing but the subsidiary data. So then the material requirement planning outputs. So the MRP program generates a variety of outputs that can be used in planning and managing the plant operations. The output includes, so we have, as we have seen the outputs in the block diagram, so the same we are going to discuss here, that is the planned order releases, which provide the authority to place the orders that have been planned by the MRP system, means which are ready to manufacture, that is nothing but the planned order releases, means we have to release the raw material to manufacture the product. Those are the planned order releases, which in that particular week we are going to manufacture the that particular number of quantities. So in order to manufacture that particular number of quantities, we have to release the raw material, that is nothing but the planned order releases. Report of planned order releases in future periods, that is nothing but in coming weeks after this particular first week is we are manufactured. So what are the quantities are manufactured in the second week, so that report, that is the report of the planned order released in the future periods, that is the second output of the MRP system. And the third output is the rescheduling notices indicating changes in the due dates for the open orders, means already the order to manufacture product is given, but because of some reasons we have rescheduled the manufacturing of that particular products, that notices will be issued by the MRP system. If there is then, and the fourth one is the cancellation notices indicating certain open orders have been cancelled because in the MPS, that is the nothing but the master production schedule, because of the problem in that particular week we are not manufacturing the products because of the technical issues, so that order must be cancelled, that is nothing but the cancellation notices. Reports of inventory status, what is the status of inventory, that will be given by the MRP system. Performance reports of various types, that is nothing but the indicating costs, item usage, actual versus planned lead times, and so on. So that is also MRP output. Exception report showing deviations from the schedule, orders that are overdue, scrap, and so on. So exception reports will give you the what is the scheduled order to be given to the customer, and whether any overdues are there, any scraps are there in the products. So that will be given by the exception report. Inventory forecasts indicating projected inventory levels in the future periods. That is nothing but the inventory forecasting, so which will be done by the sales and marketing departments. So that will be that is also the MRP output. Then the benefits of MRP system. So benefits reported by users of MRP systems include the following. So the first one is the reduction in the inventory. That is the first benefit of MRP system. So it will reduce the proper. It will helps the industry to maintain the proper level of inventory in the manufacturing industries. So too little inventory will be the also the problem. Too high inventory will also be the problem. So that we proper inventory levels should be maintained in the manufacturing industry. With the help of this MRP system, we can maintain the proper level of inventory in the industry. So quicker response to changes in demand than is possible with the manual requirements planning system. When compared with the manual material requirement planning, so this computerized MRP system will give a quicker response to the changes in the engineering changes. And the third benefit is that so reduced setup and product changeover cost. That is the reduced setup cost and product changeover cost. Fourth one is the better machine utilization. We can have a better machine utilization. And fifth benefit is that improved capacity to respond to the changes in the master schedule. So if there is any changes in the master production schedule, so that can be easily adopted in the MRP system. The MRP system will respond quickly to the changes which are produced in the master production schedule. And the final sixth one is it is a aid in developing the master schedule. Okay, so this MRP is nothing but it is the aid for developing the master schedule. Thank you.